The hour 10:15 have arrived. I will call the House Tax Committee to order when we have a quorum. We're not quite there yet, but we will start with the testimony. If Representative Fischer could please come to the table with any witnesses that he has. We will hear the Fischer bill first. And when we have a quorum, I'll be moving House File 442, and then, of course, the final motion will be to lay it over for possible inclusion, if that's what the committee desires. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to testify for the Fischer bill or with concerns on the Fischer bill? Okay, we know what that means. Okay, that's a good thing. Okay, so welcome to the Tax Committee, Representative Fischer. I believe there's a couple handouts that the pages will be handing out. There's no name on them, but there should be two handouts that we've approved that are from Mr. Representative Fischer. So those should be coming around shortly. Okay, welcome to the committee, sir, and I will be breaking in when we have a quorum to officially call the meeting to order and do a few housekeeping items. Welcome to the committee. Representative Fischer, please present your bill.
Thank you, Chair Davids and committee. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. The bill I'm presenting is to address federal tax conformity dealing with the estate tax issue. Right now, our estate tax law that we have does not match up with federal tax conformity in terms of allowing exclusion for estates up to $5 million, and this bill would address that. There is a fiscal note that is also accompanying it that I did receive that did, and I don't know if that was something that was in your packets or not, Chair Davids.
Representative, I don't think it is.
Okay, the one that I had came from the Minnesota Department of Revenue, and I apologize, I don't have copies of that. Do you need this?
It would be a revenue estimate, and it is stuck back here.
Yes, sir, that is the one.
So there's no fiscal note. There will be. Okay, we do have members. Okay. Look at the revenue note, please. Okay, so please continue, sir.
Okay, thank you, Chair Davids. And I appreciate the opportunity. This issue came up to me during this past year. I had the opportunity, I was meeting with an old cohort of mine, Bruce Mogren, who's with me here today. And we're going over a number of issues, and one of the things that we ran into is he was talking to me about the estate tax and how that has an impact going forward. And the way I knew Mr. Mogren is I've worked with him for many years in the city of Maplewood. His family, my family, go back many, many decades working together on our community. And I've had the opportunity to serve with him when he was serving on some of the task force to help redevelop our city, providing input. And also he runs and has a number of projects that have been very helpful in our area. There's several affordable housing projects that he's helped develop and continue to run in our area, some that is family affordable, and some that have been very strong on seniors. They have got a great record, been great people doing great work in our community, and he was able to enlighten me of how, with the way our estate tax structure is and how it doesn't mirror the federal tax system, that can cause problems as they try to continue these efforts in the future, as they try to pass down what they've started to their future generations. And because of the great work they've done in our community, it caused me a lot of concern, and that is one of the things between that concern and the fact that we're not matching up with the federal tax conformity. I want to make sure to also address that in the same process, and so that's why we're here today. And with your permission, I'd like to be able to turn it over to Mr. Mogren to tell a little bit about what they do and his concerns.
Thank you, Representative Fischer. Just for the record, we've said several times federal conformity. Actually, as I read this, as I stayed up late last night studying all the bills for today's meeting, I found that this really doesn't conform with the feds. It goes up to $5 million, but I think the feds are at 5.4 right now, Mr. Michael.
Mr. Chair, yes, because the federal tax is indexed each year, it generally increases. I believe the federal exemption is at $5,430,000 for decedents dying in 2015.
Okay, so, but we're getting close.
We're getting close. It's close. Moving in the right direction.
Okay, sir, please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Chair David and committee members, my name is Bruce Mogren. I reside in the city of Grant near Stillwater, Minnesota.
Welcome to committee, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to speak. Our family goes back in Minnesota Our ancestors immigrated from Sweden in the late 1800s and settled in Maplewood at the turn of the century at 1900s. And so we've been in the, Morgan family's been in the Maplewood community for over 110 years. During that time, we have a long history of entrepreneurial pursuits. My father, while working full-time for the Soo Line Railroad, started Morgan Brothers Sod Company in 1952 with his brother Bob. All of us boys, I am the second oldest of 12 boys, all boys, and it provided us with work all summer. My parents were communities, were pillars in the community. They, when each of them passed, the church was overflowing. There was over 1,000 people at each one of the funerals. And it's
Mr. Mulgrain, yes. Excuse me, as I said, I'd be interrupting once we have a quorum. And
yeah.
So hold your place here, if you would.
Sure, no problem.
I'll officially call the House Tax Committee meeting to order. Representative Simonson has studied the minutes and moves the minutes. Any additions or corrections?
He just approved them the last time.
Very studious.
He represents my daughter in Duluth.
Very well.
Oh, very well, he said. Yes, of course. Representative Simon, any additions
That's
or corrections?
She's ever had.
Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The Simonson motion is approved. Okay, thank you, Representative Simonson. Okay.
At least you were present for that.
Item next. Yeah, at least you were. Oh, well. So now I... Representative Earhart moves House File 442, so we have it properly before us. Mr. Mulgrain, please proceed, sir.
Sure, thank you very much. My personal background, I graduated from the University of Minnesota, spent 8 years in the Air Force and Air National Guard, and in 1979 started a 35-year career in real estate. First 10 years was sales, the last 25 was development. In 1990, approximately, my father and I, Jerry Mulgrain, started Mulgrain Development Company, and we used this company to develop several properties in the Maplewood area. Probably our largest and the one we're most proud of is called Carefree Chateau and Villas. It's located about a half a mile from where our ancestors settled in Maplewood. And we built this over a period of 10 to 15 years. It provides affordable senior housing for about 400 seniors, mostly from Maplewood and the east side of St. Paul. And using union labor, we built the complex. We built it in three phases so we could stabilize it and go. We are very conservative with our approach to development. And this is very much a family type business. My brother Jeffrey is the head of our maintenance. My brother Spike does all of our carpentry work. My daughter's on our small board of directors. My nephew, Josh, who has cystic fibrosis, teaches our tenants the computers and does other things. There are several family members that work on it during the summer. And this came up, this whole thing about me speaking here today came up when Peter Fischer and I were talking. I said, Peter, I'd like to meet you for a cup of coffee. And during that conversation, I said, one of the things, he asked me what concerns me. I said, one of the things that really concerns me is I just met with my tax advisor doing some estate planning. And he said, Bruce, he said, when you pass on, you're going to owe $350,000 to $400,000 to the state of Minnesota. I said, how can that be? I said, we don't have that money. And he says, no, it's not based on what you make in income. It's based on the equity that you've got in your projects. And that, I said, how can we afford to, the only way that we can afford to pay that, or my estate would be afford to pay that, would be to sell the project. Because last year we refinanced through HUD, and HUD doesn't allow secondary financing. We put a 35-year mortgage on the property because I plan on, this is a family operation, I plan on, you know, continuing long after I'm gone. So we set it up for 35 years. And like I said, HUD doesn't allow a second mortgage. And I said, the only way that we could afford, my family could afford to pay for this is to sell it. And that's not why we set it up. And it really frustrates me that this tax It's like we run our operation, I look at it, and we say, okay, we can afford this much in labor, we can afford this. We're doing some conversions to LEDs and all that. And I said, what's the point if the ultimate end game is when I die, my heirs had to come up with all this money and probably have to sell the property. So it's frustrating, and I look at other people in my contemporaries. I'm 65 years old, and a lot of my contemporaries or peers are also the same age. And other people, their tax strategy is just to take their 401ks and move to one of the other 38 states that doesn't have these draconian laws to take this. I mean, it's as simple as picking up and moving to Florida, moving to one of the 38 other states that don't have these laws. And what's happening in Minnesota is, and we go way back, I think I can speak very clearly about Minnesota. We're losing a lot of good people because, like if you take my family, I've got a brother that works with inner city kids over in North Minneapolis. He is, Peter knows him, and he just won a McKnight Award 2 years ago. I have a brother that works with Changing Gates, a program that puts sheltered horses, rescue horses in with addiction, people with addictions, alcohol and drugs. And what's happening is that the people that are leaving the state to avoid the inheritance tax are the very leaders in our communities that we don't want to see go. But it, in some ways, you're not giving them much of a choice. And I did write down a few final things, but here's my summary. Productive, experienced, community involved, and valued residents of Minnesota are leaving the state because of high inheritance tax. Minnesota is collecting approximately 10% inheritance tax for estates valued between $1.4 and $5.4 million. A large segment of the taxpayers included in this range are individuals and families that have spent decades building businesses. These families and businesses have provided numerous jobs and have paid both their share of income and property taxes. Estates are continuing to grow in value as workers prepare for retirement. With inflation in mind, they're planning larger portfolios. As more of our hardworking families exit Minnesota, we not only lose their future annual dollars, our young are deprived of their knowledge and expertise, our communities, their support, our local businesses' revenues from their consumer purchases. 38 other states offer significantly better rate comparable to the federal inheritance tax. The long-term benefits for Minnesota changing its inheritance tax to come in line with the federal inheritance tax would be good. In conclusion, I believe that there is a certain immorality to the government swooping in upon your death to take a large portion of your equity or nest egg money that you've already paid taxes on, using simply your death as an excuse. I believe that in Minnesota, any gain in tax dollars is overwhelmingly offset by the good and productive citizens it's encouraging to leave our state. It fails to generate significant revenue, boost our economy, or reduce income inequality. What it does succeed in doing is hindering entrepreneurial activities and breaking up family businesses. It simply makes common and economic sense to end this draconian tax and at least bring the exemption in line with the federal tax and the laws of the other 38 states that seen the light. There have been many states, including Tennessee, Maryland, and New York, who over the last few years have totally phased out the death tax, or at least have matched the federal exemption level. It encourages me that this bill has bipartisan support, at least on its face, because it was written by both Democrats and Republicans and forwarded. So I just hope, on behalf of my family and on many Minnesota families, hardworking people, that don't break up our businesses. You know, let us just go along. Let us continue to do our good work. And don't force us to move to other states. It just sucks. I hope that...
Mr. Morgan, we don't use swears in
I'm
here.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I apologize. Okay. I just hope that the state looks beyond the short term, the perceived tax losses, and sees the big picture. Passing this bill and accomplishing would accomplish a great good for the state of Minnesota. I'm passionate about this because really it strikes at my family and the families of others throughout the state of Minnesota. And it's not right. It's just not right. I want to just conclude with one last thing. I appreciate Peter Fischer, having the courage to, number one, listen to someone, a family who has contributed to the fabric of the community, someone who you've listened to me and you actually took action, which I find refreshing and I find courageous. So I just want to thank him for doing that, and I'm done.
Thank you, Mr. Mulgren.
Thank you.
Mr. Michael, under what we did in 2011 for farms and small business, would an enterprise such as Mr. Mulgren's, we might need more information, would that qualify for that currently? If it goes to a family member for 3 years?
No.
On a Tuesday?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, without knowing more, it would potentially, if it's a small business that meets the requirements of the statute and goes to an heir who agrees to continue to operate the small business, then up to a $5 million exemption when combined with the general exemption would be available. I don't know about the details of his situation to know whether or not he would qualify, or whether he intends, whether the heirs would agree to the 3-year requirement.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Michael. Before we get into questions, I have several folks on the list here. Is there anyone in the audience that has come in that wish to testify on behalf of the bill or with concerns at this point? Okay, then we'll go to member questions. Representative Garofalo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And first of all, Representative Fischer, thanks for carrying this bill. Good bill. So to the testifier, a couple of questions. One of the talking points against this bill and other reforms like this is that this is nothing more than a tax break for the wealthy, that this is an attack on the middle class. How would you respond to those detractors of this bill?
Mr. Mulgren.
Yes. I would say this, if this is an attack, I can't see it being an attack on the wealthy. If you look at the vast majority of the people between that 1.4 million and 5.4 million, it's people like myself, people that have spent decades building businesses, people that have their money tied up in equity, in equipment, whether you're an excavator into equipment, trucks, excavators. In order for me to run our business in a profitable way, I have to have equity. Over the last 20 years, we've consistently paid down our debt, and that's where this $5 million thing comes in. It's not that you can touch it. I drive a vehicle that's got 100,000 miles on it. Most wealthy people that I know are driving something a lot nicer than that. It's hardworking people. It's equity. That's what it is. It's what do you drive? I can see him smiling.
Chair Garofalo, what do you drive?
Mr. Chairman, to the testifier, I ask the questions here.
Okay, all right. Chair Garofalo, follow up?
And thank you for that. It's good point to make. And then the second question I have is that there's a debate at the legislature right now about whether high wealth, high income individuals are in fact, are they fleeing Minnesota? Is that happening or not? And some of the data tends to point to that no, people are happy to pay more and they're staying, and we're really not seeing any of the consequences of being a high tax state. Other people say, well, no, this is actually happening, that in addition to higher costs of government in Minnesota, just culturally, we become less tolerant to cold weather, and given the choice of paying high taxes and shoveling their driveway in May, or going somewhere warm where they don't have to pay these taxes and they don't have to shovel their snow out of the driveway in May that people are choosing that. Based on your experience, your sort of network of friends, family, I mean, do we have a problem? Are people, are high wealth, high income individuals, high equity individuals leaving our state or not?
I say absolutely, you know. There's no question in my mind because I go and visit them. I mean, they're my contemporaries, you know. Why not go to a free place, you know? It's. I think that really, to answer that question, I think that, you know, the weather, and, I mean, I don't enjoy Minnesota winters like I used to, but I think that this inheritance tax becomes a tipping point. I think it goes, okay, you've got the weather already. Why should I hang out here when I can go to a warm weather state, and plus not only that, but protect everything I've worked for. So it's I think if you come in compliance with the federal level, I think that you cover the vast majority of people that have run businesses, people that have worked hard, people that have paid taxes in this state. But to answer your question, I think there's plenty. I ask my tax preparer the same question. I asked the person that does financial planning. They said that they see a lot of clients. I'm a member of Rotary. I see a lot of our people going for warmer weather and also to avoid the taxes. So why give them an excuse? Why give them an additional excuse? If we put this in line with the feds, then I think it protects so many of the hardworking people that have spent decades building something in this state. Why take it away from them?
Chair Garofalo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think the testifier said it better than I could. I think it's important to remember that a good analogy would be here to temperature, that the difference between 32 degrees and 33 degrees is just 1 degree. That's it. However, it's the difference between water and ice. And I think that's what we're seeing with many of these tax provisions here. Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks for the questions.
Chair Carlson.
Now, Mr. Chairman, I had a question, but being the cars came up, I just thought I'd chime in. One of my cars has got about 100,000 miles. It's a 2004. One of them is a 2013 with 52,000. But I do have a question. I'm just kind of picking up on that.
Certainly.
An interesting book I read a number of years ago was called The Millionaire Next Door. And they really talk in that book about high net worth, high income, and they're not one and the same in many instances. And they devote a whole chapter to the kind of car you drive. And the one with high net worth drives the older, more modest car, and very often the high income drives the very expensive car. But in terms of who accumulates the wealth long term.
What if you're both?
Then you accumulate a whole lot, I suppose. Yeah, okay. But at any rate, it was interesting reading because there are a lot of people that are kind of under the radar screen, if you will, when you, according to the readings in that book. But I did have a question as a follow-up to yours, of Mr. Michael, because I was thinking about those law changes as well. And if you could share with us, Mr. Michael, if you happen to know it off the top of your head, how do we define a small business? That might be somewhat of a help for the testifier. Do we use the federal number, which I think is 500? Is anything 500 employees or less is small business? But I don't know if we have a separate definition for the state of Minnesota.
Mr. Michael?
Chairman, Representative Carlson, the definition of a small business in the estate tax is tied to the gross annual sales of the trade or business, and those have to be under $10 million. So it's not, there are a host of federal definitions and a variety of state definitions of small business, and it all varies depending upon the, you know, the specific provision that you're talking about. Oftentimes those are, you know, Minnesota uses it for economic development purposes to benefit. But for this, you know, probably the key thing is the gross annual sales of $10 million or less for the last taxable year that ended before the date of death. So.
Okay, Mr. Carlson. Chairman, I was just trying to be helpful, being that I thought your question was kind of leading into what the status of maybe some of the testifiers here today might be as a result of that law change. being that part of the definition was small business. So that would have to be looked at on an individual basis, I assume. Thank you.
Mr. Michael, it's $10 million per month.
No. Mr. Chairman, it was $10 million for the taxable year before the date of the decedent's death.
Taxable year before the decedent's death. Okay, Representative Earhart. Thank you, Mr. Michael. Representative Earhart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was just going to suggest, if you're not successful in with this bill, Mr. Morgan, that you need a lot of, you probably do anyway, business continuation and estate planning, because you can do a lot with what you're suggesting. It's obvious with your assets that you're describing, you can't pick those up and go to another state like some with a portfolio or
you're
whatever.
You're exactly right.
And so you have to spend some time and probably money with some the experts, and it sounds like you might be doing that, that can help you mitigate the situation that you have. And I used to be in that business, so that's why I'm telling you, if you aren't, you should be.
No, I appreciate the suggestion. I appreciate the suggestion, you know, and hopefully, this law passes, you know, people won't have to play that game. You know, it's, I think to recognize it for what it is, for people that have put a lot of time and effort into building things here in this state, hopefully, but no, I agree with you. I guess that you have to look at what you can do to mitigate it. You know, the thing that I look at is, I mean, you got the federal, government at 5.4 million. You got 38 states at the same or no inheritance tax. I mean, they must see something. They must see something. And I don't know if anyone's ever done a cost benefit from the people that are leaving Minnesota to go to one of these 38 states. Has anyone ever seen or figured out how much you're losing in not being able to tax them by them not spending their dollars here, by them you know, by them taking our community leaders out of the state? And I mean, I see it. And to answer your question, uh-huh. I see it. I see it every day. I mean, it's 60. I'm 65, so I'm right there.
Chair Earhart.
Nothing more.
Representative Moline.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I had a question for Mr. Michael. If now would be a good time for that.
Certainly. Moline.
What's the average, like, real dollar amount that an estate pays under the current law if they're subject to an estate tax?
Mr. Michael.
Mr. Chair, Representative Moline, I don't have that number right off the top of my head, so that's something I'd have to go back and get data from the Department of Revenue. I will say one thing, though, is that the average amount could be a little bit misleading unless you look at it by estate bracket size, because essentially some extraordinarily large estates can pull that average way up relative to the estates that would, say, for example, be affected by Representative Fischer's bill.
Mr. Chair, I would be interested in seeing those numbers and a breakdown like Mr. Michael suggested. We always hear this of people moving out of state or businesses moving out of state, and I just think of the exorbitant costs associated with just moving in general for anybody, but especially if you have a lot of assets that you have to take care of here at home too. So I would be interested in just seeing what the actual tax and real dollar amount that people pay, and, you know, if it is cheaper for them to move everything to another state. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Representative Moline. Any other questions for the witness or the author? Representative Lesh, I'm sorry.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. I'm kind of confused on this because I'm not sure if we covered this the last time we went over inheritance tax, but I've heard people talk about having to pay the tax. And just so I'm clear, if I can ask Mr. Michael, do you actually pay the tax, or don't you have to be dead first? So who's actually paying the tax?
Well, we're sort of less. Some people want to take it with them.
That's what I question, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Michael.
Mr. Chair, Representative Lesh, the actual check will typically be written by the personal representative or the trustee if the, you know, if the arrangement's provided that the revenue is in the trust. That will reduce the amount of the benefits that the heirs of the estate receive.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for that, Mr. Michael. And I guess what I'm confused about is I hear Mr. Mogren talk about how hard he's worked, and I believe him. I'm sure he has. But we're talking about taxing inheritance for people who didn't work for it, not the people who did work for it, because they're moving on, as you said, Mr. Chair. You can't take it with you. So I find a hard time believing that it's not, as Representative Garofalo states, just favorable treatment of rich people in the state. Because whether or not you're saying, oh, it's all tied up in assets, well, there's a whole ton of people in my district that don't have anywhere near that level of assets. And guess what? Now they're going to be paying for this. So I'm wondering about how hard they've worked and how much more now they'll have to pay in order to make up for money that's missing from rich people that can't even take it with them. So I just wanted to make that statement, Mr. Chair. Thanks.
Thank you. Members, questions?
No,
okay, can with that.
Could I respond to that?
I just knew you did.
Okay.
But you can.
Here's who's paying for it. Right there. That's my family. That's my heirs. And also, probably the people, some of the people that are working for companies like ours. You know, so anyways, I'll stop there.
Any other questions for members? Representative Fischer, thank you for bringing this bill forward. Chair Earhart renews his motion that House File 442 be laid over for possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. Thank you, Representative Fischer. And Mr. Mogren, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you very much.
Thank
appreciate
you, Mr. Chair,
your time.
Committee. Thank you.
Okay, item next. Is Chair Knobloch here?
Chair Knobloch just arrived.
Chair Knobloch just arrived. Chair Knobloch.
Mr. Chairman, do you have another bill? Because actually, Mr. Cummings is out in the hallway meeting with my witness on something.
Oh, certainly. Yes, we do. Representative McDonald. Okay, members, we're going to the House File 493. You should have everything in your packet.
Yeah, you better stay for mine, too.
What's that? Oh, good. I'll hang up.
All right.
I'm sorry.
Welcome to your committee, Representative McDonald. Representative McDonald moves that moves House File 493. First of all, I have on my list of testifiers a Ms. Crockett, Ms. Madden, and Mr. Smith. We'll hear a presentation from Representative McDonald. And then, is there anyone else in the audience that wishes to testify on behalf or with concerns on this bill? So we have three. Okay, please present your bill. And Representative McDonald moves House File 493.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, committee members. I just have a little opening statement, and then I'm going to hand it over to my testifier, the CEO, Kim Crockett, of the Center for the American Experience.
And members, before we do that, there's going to be a couple of handouts that we've approved Representative McDonald. Members, if you have things to pass out, please put your name on them so we know where they come from. So there should be two from Representative McDonald, Center of the American Experiment, and then the estate tax shoes away snowbirds. So those two pieces are from Representative McDonald. Representative McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tax his land, tax his bed, tax the table at which he's fed, tax his tractor, tax his mule, teach him taxes are the rule. Tax his work, tax his pay. He works for peanuts anyway. Tax his cow, tax his goat, tax his pants, tax his coat. Tax his ties, tax his shirt, tax his work, tax his dirt. Tax his tobacco, tax his drink, tax him if he tries to even think. Tax his cigars, tax his beers, if he cries, tax his tears. Tax his car, tax his gas.
find other ways to tax his rear. No swearing, Mr. Chairman. I edited that
Thanks
part myself.
Swear.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tax all he is, then let him know that you won't be done until there's no dough. When he screams and hollers, then tax him more. Tax him till he's good and sore. Then tax his coffin, tax his grave, tax the sod in which he's laid. Put these words upon his tomb. Taxes drove me to my doom. But when he's gone, do not relax. It's time to apply the inheritance tax. Members, my bill will repeal the inheritance tax, the estate tax, otherwise known as the death tax, because we don't have the courage to tax him while he's alive, so we get him when he's gone. Members, this bill, when it passes, hopefully with the grace of God, will be repealed by next year, and that's not soon too enough, if you ask me. Members, I have a testifier here. I would like to offer her testify as well.
Okay, before we get into that, as far as your opening comments, in Minnesota, we do not tax clothing. So.
Mr. Chair, I forgot I do have a copy for everyone. If the pages could pass these out, I forgot to put my name on it, but just members, if you have a pen, add my name to it.
Okay, please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Thank you, Chairman David. I'm Kim Crockett with Center of the American Experiment. It's also an experience, for sure, where I am the COO. Chairman David's members of the committee and Representative McDonald and Poet Laureate for the day in the state of Minnesota. I have a limited amount of time. I'm eager to come back if invited on this bill. I want to share some resources and ideas with you before I get into some details and answer questions. Repealing the estate tax in Minnesota is one of the center's top priorities. It's important to us as a nonprofit, but more importantly, it's good tax and public policy. And by the way, one of our donors is one of the wealthiest human beings in the entire world, and he drives one of the oldest cars I've ever seen. Just to your point, Representative Carlson on high net worth.
Ms. Crockett, please don't disclose my name.
Now you've given it away. As I will detail in a moment, from a tax revenue standpoint, Minnesota may be undermining its greater goals of revenue and prosperity for the state, actually taking in less revenue as a result of having an estate tax. So if you like taxes, and I know some of you do, and lots of predictable revenue, this is not your tax. From a public policy standpoint, and I think Mr. Mulgren has done a fine job in making this case, it has a ripple effect going down through generations, with grandparents and great-grandparents making permanent rather than temporary residence in other states. The domestic migration out of our state is startling, and I recommend to you the January demographer's report, the state demographer. If you grab this report and turn to figure 4 on page 6, it's shocking. We thought the migration situation was startling, but it's even more than I thought. At this point, domestic migration, which means people from the United States, is in the negative territory for Minnesota. So I recommend that report to you. Our state demographer has warned us that we have entered a new demographic era with 100,000 people coming to Minnesota, but an even greater number leaving each year. She concluded that Minnesota should work to stem and reverse those losses and seek to retain its current resident population. The migration out of Minnesota is detailed in a report from the center from 2013 based on 2010 census. Interestingly, the same title as the state demographer's report, Minnesotans on the Move. Minnesotans are mostly moving to states with a better tax climate, in some cases warmer weather. Some of us who love winter don't think it's necessarily a better climate, though. So I sat last Saturday with a neighbor of mine. He's a World War II veteran and a small businessman, 92 years old and sharp as a tack. He was distraught at the idea of having to relocate. He would be here today, but he has a beautiful wife with Alzheimer's, and the notice was just a little too short. He could come another time, perhaps. He wants to stay in Minnesota. This is where he was born and where he and his wife built their business. One of their sons, who has taken over the company, small chemical company, has already left for South Dakota. He can run the business from there. Please be assured that Minnesota is competing with all the other states and even globally for citizens from all walks of life, but especially for high income and high net worth individuals who are mobile and in a position to choose where they live and where they die. We are also competing for people who, through a lifetime of work and savings, have accumulated modest but comfortable estates that are taxed upon their death. And I, again, think Mr. Mulgren made those points really well. But this is not an argument for simply raising the threshold amount so that you can nail the super wealthy. Instead, it's an argument for repeal, since the majority of states do not have a death tax, and they're happy to benefit from the wealth of people that they've accumulated over a lifetime. So you have to decide, do you want to keep these taxpayers here as our good neighbors and near their families, or do we want to shoo them out of the state and open the door to their entire family leaving? Now, some of the specific actions people take in response to the estate tax are detailed in a memo that Peter Nelson, my colleague, prepared. It's in your packet. It has our logo at the top. Before I get to that, you had asked about numbers. I don't have them for specific brackets, but the average payment is about $146,000 per estate as of 2012, generating $177 million last year in revenue. But our position is that we're actually taking in zero or less because of the impact on other taxes in the state. And here are the things that people do. Some of it's just common sense. They change their residence to another state. They move assets to a trust in another state. For example, the Dayton family, our governor's family, and the Carlson family of Radisson Hotels maintain so-called dynasty trusts in South Dakota. You can create a family limited partnership where business owners can divide the rights to income appreciation and control the business to family members. You can spend down your estate through gifting to people with actually probably lower incomes, therefore reducing the amount of income tax that the state takes in. You can work less, you can save less and invest less to avoid hitting that that threshold for the estate tax. And you can, as Mr. Mulgren pointed out, dissolve your business if you're the heir to pay the estate tax, because you can't come up with the $300,000 or $400,000 that's due. There is a recent study in the Journal of Entrepreneurship and Public Policy that notes that states that got rid of their estate taxes saw an increase in the number of firms being started, especially smaller ones in the states. Now, the data in this area is hard to come by because nobody really tracks wealth and migration in a way that's where you can get to ironclad conclusions. The Fed does it. The census gives us some information. That's what this is based on. But the data sets are really small, and therefore it's hard. They're statistically not helpful in terms of drawing big conclusions. So as a result, you have to turn to other evidence as well as common sense as policymakers in deciding what to do. We're still working on that other evidence, and we'll be happy to share it with you, you know, when we have it. But you look at things like, what accountants and attorneys are saying. This is how Connecticut decided to get rid of their estate tax. Estate planning businesses, research that the wealthy are sensitive to estate tax rates, and so on and so forth. Evidence of second home ownership. There's a lot of different data points that we're looking at so that we can give you something like this that says for sure But I think you know, you know, when you have your common sense hats on, that people are mobile and making decisions based on what you do here in the tax committee. So with that, I'll conclude my testimony and answer any questions if you have some.
Thank you. Representative Moline.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and Ms. Crockett. You know, when we have these hearings, we have people come in and introduce themselves and say who they represent. And I think it's really important for us as lawmakers to understand who's speaking before the committee so that we can best represent our constituents and the best interests of Minnesota. And usually when it's the Chamber of Commerce or the CPAs or something like that, we understand those groups, you know, they're who their members are, they're paid for by association fees. But I have a difficult time understanding what exactly the center of the American experiment is. And now my interest is definitely piqued when you told me that one of your largest donors is one of the wealthiest men in the world.
Yep, in the world.
So I'd like to know I'd like to know who that is, and I'd like to know what exactly you are, who, you know, pays for you to be here, who are you advocating for? That would help me better make decisions on this bill.
Chairman Davids and Representative Moline, we are a 501c3, like Growth and Justice, you'll be hearing from my friend Dane Smith in a while. We do educate, we advocate and try to educate, if we can, the public and policymakers on issues like taxes, energy policy, public pensions, you name it. Education is what we're really well known for, is choice in education and strengthening families. Some of our donors, and all that information, by the way, is private, if that's what you're getting at, and I know that's what you're getting at, are very wealthy. Well, there's that one, and he's a terrific gentleman and drives the oldest car you've ever seen. Most of our board members, for example, are entrepreneurs. They've come from very little. They're scrappy and hardworking people. That reminds me of Mr. Mulgren. If he's interested in being on our board, I invite him to talk to me afterwards. They've built what they have. They've worked very, very hard. And that's the kind of typical board member that we have, and those are some of our bigger donors. And then we have a lot of members who give us like $25 a year or $100 a year or something like that. And those are just folks out there that like what we do. We advocate for free market solutions to problems. We advocate for limited government, less government, rather than more government. And, you know, that's kind of who we are. We have a website if you're interested. You can sign up for emails and learn more about us.
Does anyone have any questions about the bill? Representative Moline.
Well, Mr. Chair, I mean, I think that we as lawmakers should know who is in front of us and who is discussing bills and advocating for legislation. That's how we make decisions for our constituents. And I am very concerned with the secrecy surrounding this. She continues to reference one of the wealthiest men in the world, but won't identify who it is, and has, you know, said that all their donors are completely secret. And I just don't know how I can make decisions for my constituents on a piece of legislation when the main advocate for that has all this secret information that she won't share with lawmakers. And so it's difficult for me to understand what the Center for American Experiment actually is. I know that they advocate for a variety of issues, but, you know, with the secret money surrounding the organization, I'm just not comfortable in, you know, going back to my constituents and saying, I support this bill because this organization that's secret and keeps all their donors secret is really supportive of it. So that was my question, and I think that you know, it was important in regards to this bill, and I have nothing further. Thank you, Mr.
Chair.
Representative McDonald.
Since it's my bill, I'd like to address the concern. I'll tell you who's the main advocate of the bill that I have in front of you. It's the businesses, the small family mom and pop shops of Bright County. It's the family farms. It's the Nathan brothers, my ex, that have a business out in Hollywood Township. Those folks are the main advocate. I invited Kim Crockett here to be a testifier and to share with you some data that indicates that people do move with their dollars.
in my little small world of Wright County, in the small little town of Delano, of the population of 5,464, four people have already moving out of state. And with that comes their dollars. They're not donated to the churches, to the health clubs, to the organizations, to the Lions Club, the Kiwanis, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's what's happening. The data in front of you that Ms. Crockett has given you are factual data that people do move. And the monies that they take with them are far more than the puny tax, the inheritance tax, the unfair tax that we tax in Minnesota. So my advocates for my bill are small farms, businesses, people that have worked hard in the county that I represent. That's who the advocates are with my bill. Thank you, Representative Moline, for asking the question.
Mr. Chair, I mean, just to that point, Representative Fischer, at least, you know, brought a Minnesotan in here who was, you know, willing to show his face and talk about his story and his family's personal story, and I think that that touches us all more. But it was your choice to have an organization that has a bunch of secret donors, but I would like to know who the wealthiest man in the world is that funds your organization.
Oh, he doesn't run, Chairman Davids.
Go through the chair. Representative Moline, were you finished with your question?
I'm done. I didn't have a question, just a response to Representative McDonald. I know there are other people that wanted to get on the list.
Like quite a few.
Yes, yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
You have the floor.
I'm done.
Okay, Chair Drazkowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, I do need to report that my vehicle, which is a 1999 Dodge Ram that, as a pauper myself, I bought brand new, believe it or not, in 1999, has 445,000 miles on, and it's dead. And so I bought a new truck, and it's got 132,000 miles on it. So anyway, the context of the discussion here was kind of interesting. But thank you for your bill, Representative McDonald, and thank you for the poem. And you might want to take this to the bar with me someday or something, huh? Is that what you're saying?
Just don't take it to your grave.
Yeah, exactly. The discussion about, I'm hearing almost a contempt among some members of this committee about people who work hard and accumulate wealth, and apparently that's what this particular tax is aimed at. It's aimed at punishing people for their success. And, you know, and I wonder, as we have built this humongous government in the state of Minnesota that continues with an appetite that's insatiable to fund our many categories of assistance, welfare, benefits, subsidies, and others, from cash assistance to housing welfare to transportation subsidies to food for people to health care welfare to higher education welfare to legal services for free to daycare subsidies to everything down and down the list, and we grow this big unending government that has an appetite for people's money, and then we have policy that chases the people out of the state that have the most ability and are, at least at some point, were paying the largest percentage of the cost of this. And obviously it chased Governor Dayton's money out of the state. Governor Dayton's a bright guy, and he realized that the policies we have here in this state don't make sense for him and his money. And so I understand that. I mean, definitely under the bill, Representative McDonald, you pointed out, people are leaving this state because they don't want to submit their estate to these onerous taxes, and they worked all their life, and they want their children to be able to have a place to start off as they move forward. I just wonder, as we do this and chase the people who are most able to pay the costs of this humongous government that we've developed out of this state, what does that mean for Representative Lesh's constituents, Representative Simonson's constituents, Representative Dabney's constituents, Representative Carlson's, Representative Wills, Representative Lencheski, Representative Erickson. I could go all the way around the table to everybody. Their constituents who work hard every day, who might not be in such a good position, what does that mean for them, the people who remain here after the people who leave this state with their wealth and take it with them to South Dakota and other places, what does that mean for them? So I'd be interested, Mr. Chair, if either Ms. Crockett or Representative McDonald could respond to that.
Representative McDonald?
Mr. Chair, thank you, Representative Drozdowski. That reminds me of a quote by a gentleman who I admire. He said, democracy will cease to exist when you take away from those who are willing to work and give it to those who would not. Thomas Jefferson. So if you shake your head at that quote by Thomas Jefferson, well, I'd have you read Thomas Jefferson's biography. So what happens, Representative Drozdowski, is the monies leave and there's fewer monies to fund to help the elderly, the poor, the homeless, our school children, and so on and so forth. Those dollars leave, those important dollars that are supposed to fund important things that the government should do, educate our children, take care of those who can't take care of themselves, pave the roads, fix the bridges. That's what happens when you chase wealth away. We'll have less money to fund the very things that we hold dear and near to our heart. That's what happens. Thank you for the question.
Chair Drozdowski.
I'm wondering if Ms. Crockett has a response. Mr.
Ms. Crockett.
Chairman Davids, Representative Drozdowski, and I apologize for speaking out of turn earlier. My temper got the best of me. Our report that I mentioned that we released, Minnesotans on the Move, demonstrates, based on census, that between 1995 and 2010, based on 2010 dollars, about $340 million in income, or over $5 billion over that period alone, has left the state in taxable income. So as I said before, if you love tax revenue and you like, in this committee, I think, predictable tax revenue, the estate tax is not your tax. It's our contention that the $170 million or so that you're pulling, that you pulled in last year, is washed out by all the other revenue you could be collecting in income, property, sales tax, the other taxes that is leaving the state as a tax base. So, in other words, you're not making up any ground with this. It's bad tax policy and bad social policy.
Chair Drozdowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Ms. Crockett and Representative McDonald. And you know, I guess the point I was hoping to hear and is that we have this huge government that remains after the rich people and their money is chased out of the state. The monster government that we have is still here eating, and it needs to be fed. And so the poorer people in our state are going to be forced with onerous bills and increasing taxes on them in order to continue to pay this beast that we've created after we chase these people out of the state that have been paying the largest portion of the bill. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Representative Drozdowski. Chair Lesh? Chair Knobloch?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I guess we're kind of past the issue I was going to raise, but I've been gone for a few years, but my recollection is that the Center for American Experiment's been around for a long time and has been here many, many times. I guess, Ms. Crockett, how many years has your organization been in existence?
This year's Chairman Davids, Representative Knobloch, this year is the 25th year of Center of the American Experiment.
And Mr. Chairman, Ms. Crockett, haven't I seen you or many other contributors from the Center of the American Experiment writing various editorials and treatises and papers and studies that have been published all over the state for those 25 years?
Absolutely.
Ms. Crockett?
Chairman Davids, Representative Knobloch, yes.
Mr. Chairman, Ms. Crockett, am I right in thinking that your organization, I guess, well, you do have one wealthy individual apparently who is a donor, has several thousand donors?
No.
Ms. Crockett?
Chairman Davids, Representative Knobloch, that is correct.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Ansells.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, Representative McDonald, we're going to have a very huge philosophical conflict here. To think that it's in the public interest of this great state that we're going to give a tax cut of this proportion to millionaires while we have poverty and all sorts of social issues out there that are not being properly addressed. It just amazes me that somebody as smart as you would conclude that it's a good idea to take 170, 180, 190 million out of state government's ability to provide services without a corresponding plan. As your testifier has mentioned, one of the goals of the center is to reduce the size of government. Now, how are you connecting reducing tax burdens for wealthy millionaires with reducing the size of the government? Does it come automatically? Or what are your proposals should this be enacted? And I certainly hope it doesn't. How would you reduce the size of government then?
Representative McDonald.
Thank you. Representative Van Zels, I first want to thank you for the compliment that said I was a smart guy. That was the nicest compliment I've received all day, and I'm going to let my mom know that as well and wife at home. Is this on recording?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah. Well, thank you. Representative Van Zels, that's a great question. However, the one area of not quite accuracy is that this does not just apply to millionaires, like you said. It applies to many small families and family farms in my district who aren't millionaires by any means of the imagination. Many of them have assets, so they don't have that liquid cash, but they have the assets that they will be able to pass down to their children so they continue businesses and to be paying taxes and so on and so forth. So this isn't a tax cut for the rich. This is an unfair tax. It's an intolerable tax to tax someone when they're dead. We don't have the guts enough to tax them while they're alive. We should not be taxing them while they're dead. So philosophically, we are far, far removed. You think we should tax them when a person dies.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. I won't belabor this, but I don't believe I got an answer about how it is Representative McDonald and others who support this legislation, with the guidance of the Center for the American Experience at the helm here, I don't know how you propose to reduce the size of government, but I'll let it go.
Thank you, Representative Ansells. Representative Simonson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And you know, a comment before my question. Representative McDonald, you just said in response to Representative Ansel's question that this is not a tax cut for the rich. And I think I understood that correctly. And I want you to know that I appreciate your passion for what you're trying to do. And I understand who you're representing and what you're trying to accomplish. But the data that we see here in front of us tells me that in 2013, less than 2% of Minnesotans would have been subject to the estate tax. And going forward, the affected number is, in 2014, only 1.26% of estates would be subject to the tax. So when I consider the people in my district, and, you know, I almost actually agree with Representative Duszkowski on a point, which is good, right? It is amazing. and the point is that within my district, I've got 98% of the people that I represent that aren't subject to the estate tax. Okay, I don't have a rich district. I don't have people with a lot of money, large estates. I don't have any farms. So I've got to go back tomorrow and say, okay, folks, Representative McDonald and Ms. Crockett from the Center for the American Experiment are advocating to reduce revenues
to the tune of about $130 to $170 million each year, which is a lot of money. And they're not going to care because it doesn't affect them, right? But then I'm going to tell them, you know what, it does affect you because that's a sizable hole in our budget. And I think it's okay for me to ask the question of either one of you or both, how do you plan on filling this hole? And I know, Mr. Chair, you don't like that question maybe, not all the time, but I'm going to ask it today. How do we fill this hole? Because I want to tell my constituents, the 98% of them that don't have to worry about being subject to an estate tax, I want to tell them what we're going to lose. Because we're either going to fill this with revenue from somebody else, or we're going to reduce the size of government, as has been suggested. But I think it's a fair question to ask either one of you exactly on the record, how do you anticipate filling this hole?
And again, members, we're hearing ideas on DFL bills and Republican bills. We're not putting the tax bill together today, so we want to hear about ideas. We're not necessarily figuring out how the budget will be settled. But Ms. Crockett, to the question.
Chairman Davids and Representative Simon, I would submit to you that my goal of shrinking government is not achieved by repealing the estate tax. On the contrary, what I'm saying to you today is that the $170 million or so that was collected last year is washed out by the people don't stay put. They do things to avoid it. So if you repealed the tax, you'd actually have higher revenues. I didn't make that explicit enough. You'll take in more money. So for the 98% of people in your district that are looking to the state for services that are funded through taxes, or maybe services that are come from their church or other foundations, nonprofits, the pie will be bigger, is what I'm saying. The goal of shrinking government is a different policy argument. That's not what we're talking about today. So just to be very clear, by repealing the estate tax in Minnesota, all things being held equal on other taxes, you'll have more revenue. It won't be immediate because these aren't things that happen in, you know, overnight, but all things being held equal, you'll actually probably bring in more tax dollars. That's why I said, if you love taxes and you love revenue for the state of Minnesota, this isn't your tax. It chases dollars out of the state.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Simonson and members, we have Representative Simonson, Petersburg, Lesh, Barrett. Then I'm going to go to several folks that have come to testify with concerns about the bill. And then we'll open up for member questions. Representative Simonson.
To that point, and thank you, Ms. Crockett, for explaining that. But I think what you're telling me is that if we repeal this tax, yes, we lose in the neighborhood of $170 million of annual revenue. But I think what you're saying is that we'll make it up on the flip side from the people that will choose to stay in Minnesota, spend their dollars in Minnesota, invest in Minnesota. I think that's what you're telling me. And that, Mr. Chair, I think it's anecdotal evidence because I don't see anything in the fiscal note that tells me that. So I think we need to put that in perspective. And as we go forward, if this becomes part of the larger omnibus bill, I'm very curious to hear from staff at some point in time, not today, kind of our nonpartisan response to that question, if you will. So I'll leave it at that, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Representative Simonson. And just for the record, the budget surplus about what $1.3 billion, we'll have a portion of that in this committee, and I'm calculating about $8.357 billion in requests. So we'll, you know, we're off a little. Okay, Representative Petersburg.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This question, just clarification for me from understanding from Mr. Michael. Am I correct that what I've been reading, that when your estate is calculated for whether or not it qualifies for this, life insurance is also included in that?
Mr. Michael?
Mr. Chairman, Representative Petersburg, yes. If the decedent owned life insurance, that would be included. The only way life insurance is not included is if ownership was successfully transferred to another entity or to an individual.
And to that point, Mr. Michael, if the spouse owns it and the other spouse passes away, is there any time limit they can do that, or do they have to, is there any look back or claw back on that?
Mr. Chairman, if the spouse owns it, it would essentially qualify for the marital deduction, and so it would not be taxed. The transfer out of the ownership of the decedent would need to be made within that, beyond that three-year period, or the portion that was transferred as a taxable gift within the 3 years would be pulled back in.
Mr. Michael, what if you have been paying premiums, your basis is less than the value, or the basis is greater than the value of the cash value? We'll talk about that. That's good. Representative Petersburg.
Thank you. To me, that indicates that there could be a lot of people out there that are going to hit this threshold and not realize it because they didn't realize that it was being going to be included in their assets. So it could be more than that. But the point that I want us to remember is that as an individual, I'm not caring about myself paying the tax upon my death, because at that point I'm not going to care. Who's actually paying the tax or who is actually not benefiting from having to pay the tax are all the heirs that are out there. And that's more than that 2%. Even if you were to say there's only 3.5 people in your family, that automatically starts bringing that closer to 10%. And then if there are additional heirs to it, all of those heirs are now going to be paying that tax in loss of asset that's being transferred. We know that this generation is going to be passing on the largest wealth of assets around, and so it's no wonder we want to tax that piece. But it really is going to impact the future of those that are accumulating that asset, especially if they have to sell it in order to accomplish it. So I also agree that this is probably not a good fiscal responsibility for us to tax somebody when they're dead. So thank you.
Well, when I die, if I die, I'll still care. Chair Lesh.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Must be a country western song.
Write that down. Yeah.
Chair Lesh.
Get the author of the bill to write up a little poem for you on that, Mr. Chair.
Already started.
So, Ms. Chair, my question is for Ms. Crockett. And Ms. Crockett, I may be compelled on your reasoning that we'll get more rich people back in Minnesota if we repeal this, and it'll be good for the overall economy outside of government. But I recall when I used to work down at City Hall, folks would come to the city council asking for money for a certain project that they wanted to do. And they always promised us that, well, trust us, if you give us $100,000 to build this development, heck, the development around it will spring up, and you'll actually generate even more tax dollars in the long run, so you make the pie bigger, as you stated. But the city council said, well, hang on a second. We're not just going to take your word for it. We need a certain number of units pre-sold in this building that you're going to build so that we know, in fact, that you're on the road, you're going to make this happen, and we have some level of guarantee that you're going to succeed in this endeavor, and the pie is going to get bigger. So they'd want a 200-unit condominium complex and said, well, you got to have, and the financiers would say that, too, before they gave them money. You need 50% pre-sold. So on this bill, do we have some kind of guarantee? Can you guarantee us a certain number of rich people are going to come back into Minnesota and make our pie bigger? And I'm talking some names. And you don't have to name all of them, but maybe give us half a dozen rich people that would really kind of get us salivating here, and then maybe a few billionaires to be named later or something. Can you name a few rich people that we get out if we pass this?
Ms. Crockett.
Chair Davids, Representative Lesh, I'm not sure that's a serious question.
It's a serious question.
I've been listening to Representative McDonald next to me, thinking that he might be hit by this tax because of a life insurance policy, so I'll give you Representative McDonald's name as a possibility.
I think that's going to be good enough.
My neighbor.
Even though I like
him. My World War II veteran, who was in tears, by the way. He's a pretty sophisticated guy. And I was really surprised that he wasn't aware of the estate tax rule. I stopped by and was chatting with him and mentioned my Strib article, and He was in tears. He's 92. His wife is, he's got to watch her all the time, and now he's got to call his lawyer and his accountant. I'm pretty sure if you pass this bill, that's one more Minnesota native and family that would stay put. And out of respect for his privacy, I won't tell you who he is, but I'm going to try to get him down here to the committee so you can meet him. He's a pretty neat guy.
Thank you, Ms. Chair. And Ms. Crockett, as you can imagine, we need to know something other than just simple anecdotes. If we know that, if you're suggesting, no, actually, overall, the pie is going to get bigger overall, trust us doesn't work. I mean, that's why we have revenue notes and fiscal notes, too, because if we could actually book the savings for this stuff, it would be a very different story. But we can't. Just like with early childhood, you get $7 back on every $1 you spend. Well, if we could book that savings, we'd solve the budget problem every year. But you can't book it. Just like with this, you can't book it. So, Mr. Chair, I just say I was excited about the prospect of getting some more rich people here. So if you find out any more folks that really can make our pie bigger, I'd love to hear that, Ms. Crockett. Thank you,
Chairman
Mr. Chair.
Chairman Davis, Representative Lesh, I'll give you a call.
Ms. Crockett.
I'm on the edge of my seat.
Okay, I did miss Representative Dabney earlier, so I've got Barrett Dabney. Then we are kind of eating into the time of the folks with concerns, but Vice Chair Barrett.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative McDonald. Quick question for you. How many families are going to benefit from the bill if it's passed into law?
Representative McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Representative Barrett. There isn't, to my knowledge, there's no substantial evidence that would show us how many families. I can tell you that just in my little county of Wright, there's several handfuls of families that would benefit. Certified public accountants recently did a survey of their clients throughout the state of Minnesota, and they concluded that over 86% of their clients will and are considering moving out of the state of Minnesota. That's a high number by a pretty good firm. CPAs are kind of smart guys. They got numbers and they got clients and families and business, and that's pretty alarming. So if we ignore that, we're going to be in trouble. Mm.
So without getting into hyperbole, it's a few hundred, a few thousand, but certainly it's more than one.
Yes.
Representative McDonald.
Thank you. Yes.
Vice Chair Barrett.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, this kind of, you know, we have some money invested in this bill, as we did for the previous bill. Representative Fischer's bill, I think, was, you know, had some money invested in that, too. And I'm kind of surprised that none of these questions asked of Representative McDonald's bill was asked of Representative Fischer. I'm confused by that. There was a word earlier, confused, and philosophical conflict. But my point really is related to the question of filling the hole. You know, a year ago, a huge, I wouldn't call it a tax break, it was more a subsidy, was given to a billionaire owner of a professional football team in Minnesota. And before I go on with that thought, Ms. Crockett, that wasn't the rich person that we've been asking for, was it? Is it Ziggy Wolf?
Ms. Crockett, you don't have to answer that question.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm assuming it's
Vice
not.
Chair Barrett.
So we gave $350 million at the state level to a rich billionaire who employs millionaires. But not only that, we gave him a $1 billion football stadium because we gave him naming rights and all sorts of benefits. He doesn't have to pay property tax on that. We didn't do that. People correct me at home. Barrett, why do you say we when you didn't do it, when other folks did it? They're right. One party did that to one billionaire owner. And how'd you fill the hole? You filled the hole with a non-voter approved school levy. You filled the hole with a family car tax, also known as a wheelage tax. You filled the hole with taxes on satellite TV. You filled the hole by taxing people who are addicted to nicotine. That's how that hole was filled. So confusion, philosophical conflict, yeah, there is. I have a lot of that right now with why that happened. It just doesn't make sense to me. And to benefit one billionaire from the state of New Jersey.
So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Vice Chair Barrett. Representative Dabney, then we're going to go with both the concerns. Could you hold that thought? I really want to get, I have to get to the people that wish to testify. With
I just wanted to say, Mr. Chairman, that, that vote on the Viking Stadium was a mixed vote, and one of the chief negotiators for that was none other than Maury Lanning, Republican from Moorhead. So it was a very mixed vote, and when I make those statements, I happen to have been on no vote, and I want that understood that it was not a partisan vote at all.
I just
thank
wish
you.
I had a re-vote on that.
If I could, Mr. Chair.
Vice Chair Barrett.
Yeah, the vote I'm referring to is the 2013 tax bill that gave $1 billionaire owner from the state of New Jersey $350 million. That's the vote I'm referring to, and I don't think that was a bipartisan vote.
Okay, back on House File 493, Representative Dabney, and then we'll go to folks that have concerns.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative McDonald, you used the term in your presentation about how taxes should be fair. Is it fair to give a tax break to millionaires and require middle-class Minnesotans to pay the same tax?
Representative McDonald, is that fair?
Mr. Chairman, I don't think that's fair.
Representative Dabney.
Well, Mr. Chair, Representative McDonald, that's what you're doing, and so I'm confused. Middle-class Minnesotans have to pay capital gains on appreciated assets. You're suggesting that millionaires should not have to pay the same tax on appreciated assets. It's fundamentally unfair to exempt the wealthy from taxes because they're wealthy, but respect the middle class, expect the middle class to pay those same taxes. So I'm troubled by your approach, but I'm also troubled by your presentation where you suggested that without any facts from either Ms. Crockett or you, that people were fleeing the state to avoid the estate tax, and that you were concerned particularly about the impact on local communities and giving, that there would be no, that these wealthy people would leave, not give to the Kiwanis Club, not give to the Lions Club, not give to their churches, and so on. Well, the Urban Institute, a conservative, also a, I believe a 501c3 nonprofit, but a conservative think tank, did some projections on the federal level about what would happen if the estate tax was repealed to charitable giving. And what they found, based on a long history of research in the area, was we would see anywhere between a 22 and 37% decrease in charitable giving if you repealed the estate tax, as you propose here. Now, to bring that home to Minnesota, we see the latest numbers I've been able to get is 2012, individuals gave in Minnesota $4.1 billion. That's a lot of charitable giving to homeless shelters, to medical concerns, to youth development organizations, to children's hospital, to the Minneapolis Crisis Nursery to help prevent child abuse. They gave four, and you know, any host of the YMCA, the YWCA, their local church, whatever it may be, they gave $4.1 billion. Under your bill, Minnesota charities who meet the needs of Minnesotans would lose between $902 million and $1.5 billion in charitable contributions. Do you want to create a state with less activities being for all the Minnesotans through the churches, through community organizations, through YMCA, YWCA, and others? Because that's the impact of your bill, sir.
Professor McDonald, do you want to hurt churches?
Mr. Chairman, I do not want to hurt churches.
Okay.
Well, Mr. Chair,
Representative Dabney.
Representative McDonald, I'm confused. You've told me that taxes should be fair and that the wealthy should pay as much as the middle class, and yet your bill exempts the wealthy from paying taxes that middle-class Minnesotans are required to pay. And you've told me you don't want to hurt churches and nonprofits and the services they provide, and yet actual facts, actual research, and a large body of research going back decades shows that your bill will do exactly that.
Okay, thank you. Now what we'll do is we will go to, you know, I think next week we should schedule something less controversial. Like commissioner pay raises or something, I'm not sure. Okay, so let's go to Nan Madden and Dane Smith. I think you can come up together maybe, is that okay? And I apologize for, I mean, we'll give you all the time we have, but it's probably not gonna be equal to the other side.
And could you please provide me with a list of your wealthy donors? Who would like to go first, Ms. Madden or Mr. Smith?
Ms. Madden will go first.
Go ahead and have a seat here. I don't need to be sitting here anyway.
Thank you. Excuse me.
Welcome to the Tax Committee. Who would like to go first?
I'll go first, if that's okay, Mr. Chair.
Okay, please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. My name is Nan Madden. I'm director of the Minnesota Budget Project. We are a research and advocacy organization that promotes public policies that expand opportunity and economic security to all Minnesotans. I am going to direct my remarks to the bill before you, which would repeal Minnesota's estate tax, although they do apply to some degree to the other estate tax bills heard today and last week. So I'd like to raise three primary concerns. First, that the cost of this bill will crowd out other priorities. Second, that it creates an unlevel playing field among Minnesota taxpayers. And third, that it would reverse progress towards a more even distribution of taxes in our state. So first, the cost of the bill. This bill with full repeal cost $129 million in the 16-17 biennium and $341 million in the next biennium. And that comes on top of $110 million in cuts to the estate tax that were passed last year. Certainly, Minnesota today is on sounder financial footing, and the November forecast did measure a positive balance for the upcoming biennium. And that allows a different kind of conversation and a different set of options in front of you than some of the options we've had during the frequent budget deficits that we've seen over the past decade or so. I do question whether repealing or significantly cutting the estate tax on about 800 large estates should take priority over other choices you could make that would have a greater impact on Minnesotans across the state, such as sustainably funding our nursing homes, making childcare and higher education more affordable, or passing a more broadly based tax cut. My second concern is that the estate tax plays an important role in providing a level playing field among taxpayers, and that is because of that issue of the unrealized capital gains. So, for example, if I get a raise, a $10,000 raise, I will pay income tax on that increased income. If I have some stocks that appreciate in value and I sell those stocks during my lifetime, I'll pay tax on that additional income. But if I have that stock that appreciates in value and I don't sell it during my lifetime and I somehow find a way to pass that on in a large estate, then that capital gains would never be taxed. And this is a substantial amount of the value that is in large estates. Some research on estates nationally finds that unrealized capital gains make up a large portion of the assets that are found in estates. Unrealized capital gains are about a third of estates worth between 5 and 10 million and are 55% of the value in estates worth more than $100 million. So I think this issue about fairness among taxpayers is a central one for me when I think about the estate tax. The third concern is that this bill would reverse our recent progress in making our tax system less regressive. Thanks to the tax bills that were passed in 2013 and 2014, the distribution of state and local taxes in Minnesota is now more even across income levels. The share of income that the highest income Minnesotans pay in state and local taxes has gotten closer to what low and middle income Minnesotans pay, although it is still lower than the average. But that gap would start to open up again if we pass this bill. I just want to add just one point on the migration issue. And I think the research that we've seen suggests that the revenue gain by repealing the estate tax is not made up, is not made up by increased increases in other taxes paid by retaining those individuals in the state. So I think that's a point that you'll have to weigh of what is the priority on that issue compared to other decisions you could make this session.
Thank you, Ms. Madden. And before we go to Mr. Smith, for you two, I'm not able to give you the equal amount of time today. So as the committee moves forward, we'll be talking estate tax in the future, too. You'll certainly have all the time you need. A couple points. First of all, one reason we're spending a little more time on this is because Chair Knobloch's House File 296, he's working with a resource person from the Department of Revenue on some issues on the bill, Mr. Cummings. So we will be pulling that bill from the agenda today, and we'll hear that at a later date. Also, exciting news, I've got the governor's tax bill, and I'm the author of it. And it's really cool. You should see the emails I get from my base. It's just amazing. Can't believe it. So as a courtesy, as Chair Lancheski has done in the past, she's carried bills that maybe she didn't quite agree with so much, possibly from governors of the party opposite. And so as a tradition in the tax committee, the chair carries the governor's tax bill, regardless of thoughts on it. So just a little disclaimer there. Ms. Madden, before we go to Mr. Smith, what's your position on House File 442, the Fischer bill that we heard earlier today?
You know, some of the concerns, I think, carry over to that bill and the bill you heard last week. I think one of the decisions that that the committee members will need to keep in mind is that raising the exemption level their effect is not limited to raising the exemption level, but they also do provide a reduction in estate tax to larger estates that would still be eligible for the estate tax. So I think there are ways you could address the exemption level without the same amount of loss of revenue.
Thank you, Ms. Madden. Okay, Mr. Smith, please state your name and who you represent for the record, please, and provide us with your testimony.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I'm Dane Smith. I'm the president of Growth and Justice, and we're an organization that does research and advocacy for a broader prosperity in Minnesota, especially public investments in human capital and physical infrastructure that we know are conducive to healthy, long-term private sector growth. And we are very encouraged to see some rather amazing business growth in Minnesota in recent years, and also increasingly bipartisan and even ideological consensus around the fact that there is not enough justice in this growth. Specifically, I'm talking about the overwhelming evidence of growing economic and racial inequality in our nation and our state. Most everybody finally now agrees that growth is not being shared in anywhere nearly an equitable fashion, or at least compared to previous decades, and is not even trickling down, at least yet. The news recently that the top 1% globally would soon have more than half the world's wealth, and continuing evidence that middle-income wage earners are seeing no increase despite soaring business profits and job growth in number of jobs, and this is true in Minnesota, is further evidence that something is askew with our global, national, and state economic system. And when we see U.S. senators from Marco Rubio of Florida on the right to Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts on the left agreeing that we have an inequality crisis, I think that's progress. And Pope Francis is pretty persuasive on this subject, too, and super capitalist Warren Buffett actually supports a higher estate tax. So we're pleased to hear people like our own House Speaker, Kurt Dowd, emphasize these facts of economic inequality and middle-class stagnation and racial disparities in his public comments about Minnesota's biggest policy challenges. And our own research in 2013 showed that in Minnesota, although we're still not quite unequal as other states and the nation as a whole, inequality is worsening over time at a faster rate than other states. This report showed a steep decline during the recession in median income, an increase in the poverty rate, and in overall inequality as measured by the classic formula known as the Gini coefficient. In this context, we think a policy of doing no further harm to our inequality situation is a good principle in both tax policy and on the appropriation side of state and local government ledgers. And so a repeal of the estate tax or any significant reduction in inheritance taxes or top-tier income almost certainly would exacerbate inequality in Minnesota. Taxes may not actually be the most important factor in this inequality, We agree with our friends at the Center of the American experiment that family fragmentation is a factor. Trade policy, outsourcing, immigration, technology revolution, automation, all these play an important part. But tax policy certainly is a factor, a strong, an important one. And declining effective rates at the top for income, capital, and wealth over the last 30 years have to be considered as contributors to this inequality. We do not oppose any and all tax cuts. Certainly, we support increases in credits and deductions for child care, renter's credit for early childhood education, various other forms of relief for middle and low-income families, excuse me, especially if it's somehow targeted to education and training.
You're kind of having a little trouble there. If you need some Mexican Coke, I got some.
Mexican Coke, great.
Cola.
Oh, cola.
Just trying to help.
And you could always legalize that and get some revenue off that, especially if it's, again, we do favor tax credits, tax relief for if it's targeted to education and training and improving human capital. We do agree with Nan's analysis at the Minnesota Budget Project and her concern that the total cost of the estate tax elimination on top of some $100 million recently bestowed would amount to well over $500 million through FY 2017. So just imagine how much relief and purchasing power that would afford to that huge portion of our Minnesota households who make less than the median income of $60,000, and by definition, that's over half of all Minnesotans, somewhere around 2.5 million people. We could actually move the needle on inequality if we pass through some of these proposed tax cuts in the estate tax through these other low-income credits and relief rather than the really small estimated number of 800 beneficiaries a year of the estate tax elimination. We know there is strong bipartisan support in this legislature for this kind of relief for working households who are unlikely to ever have multi-million dollar estates to leave to their heirs, but who stand a better chance of making it to that stratosphere if we give them and their children and their heirs a hand up now. So thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Be happy to answer any questions or try to.
Thank you, Mr. Smith, for your testimony. Same question that I had for Ms. Madden. What's your position on House File 442?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, same as hers.
Thanks for clearing that up. Okay, I have Chair Carlson, Representative Petersburg, Chair Anderson. Chair Carlson.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to point out there was the point made that there was a difference in the debate between the two bills, and one bill did happen to have a cap. It was basically matching federal law relative to estates. I think the intent was probably conformity. It was $5 million, and our discussion at the beginning was that the feds with an adjustment now are at 5.4. The other bill completely eliminated the estate tax, hence I think that's what was generating at least part of the debate from some of the members of the committee.
Thank you, Chair. Carl Smurfs from Petersburg.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I think this probably goes to Ms. Madden, who brought up the idea of capital gains on the estate of those that grew. We've had a lot of discussion about how perceptions are that the estate tax is a fair tax, that it represents really the best thing since apple pie, I think has been a used word there. But the question that I have is since your parameter is that those that have gained capital gains and then die, then they aren't qualified or they don't no longer have to pay that. How much capital gains would, say, an estate that's $999,000 pay?
Ms. Madden?
Mr. Chair, Representative, could you repeat the ending part of your question? Are you asking me how much estate tax they would pay at a certain level?
Representative Petersburg?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, your inference was that part of the estate tax was to justify or to compensate for capital gains that were not realized in taxes. And so therefore, we certainly ought to be paying that. And my question is, if your estate, bereaved families that are having to deal with the estate, is $999,000, how much of that, quote, capital gains through the estate tax would be paid?
Ms. Madden.
Mr. Chair, Representative, if I am understanding your your question correctly, you're referring to it as a state that is below the level, so they would not pay a state tax. So that in that case, they would not be paying capital gains.
St. Petersburg.
Well, to me, thank you. I that's the way I understood it too. So it means to me that means that they've already received a tax credit, and if that's fair for them without that level, why wouldn't it be fair across the board? In other words, if the estate tax are really so great and wonderful that it's really a benefit to the society, then why do we have a limit on it at all? Why shouldn't the estate tax be from all the way from 100,000 or 10,000 on up? And why just a million or 5 million or whatever? It seems to me that we are really reinforcing the idea that certain income levels should have different taxing rates than others, even though we want to say that taxing is fair across the board.
Peter, don't make it worse. Don't go the other way. A question for Mr. Smith. Thank you, Representative Petersburg. Mr. Smith and Ms. Madden, I just want to clarify. We have the Petersburg bill. We have this bill, and Chair Carlson was clear on, you know, they are different. Do you support working with the committee on any estate tax changes, or you just don't like them?
Chairman Davids.
Yeah, Mr. Smith.
Members of the committee. The former option.
Okay.
We'd be interested in of course, in adjusting any real problems or unfairnesses or inconsistencies.
I still like the list of your rich donors.
Oh, sure. I'd like to address that, actually.
I got one question. We're going to shut it down, then we'll go have some.
Can I respond to the chair's question?
Ms. Madden.
Mr. Chair, just to respond a little more to your question is, you know, I think that the legislature has done a great deal already to try to increase the exemption for family businesses and farms. And so I think, you know, I think the point I would like to make is that the committee needs to focus on what is its concern, and if the concern is primarily the exemption level, there is a revenue neutral way to raise the exemption level that offsets the revenue loss. So, you know, some these bills include changes in exemption levels, but also rate changes. The large estates benefit from the change in the exemption level. So I think kind of untangling those different issues is an important concern for this committee.
And Ms. Madden, I'd like to follow up with you later, maybe make an appointment or something. I'd like to hear about the revenue neutral thing. We have one question, then we're going to have to fly. Chair Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And, you know, I'm trying to remember back to 2013 if you came and testified, because in the first round of the tax bill that we had, there were increases on regressive tax increases on things like tobacco and corporate sales, alcohol. These are all regressive taxes. This year we have, of course, the gas tax, which would be regressive. Are those things that you guys generally support? Did you support those tax increases, or are you opposed to those as well?
Ms. Madden?
In relation to the 2013 tax bill, it was very important to us that that bill was progressive overall, which it was. So there were increases in income taxes that offset the regressive nature of the other taxes.
Chair Anderson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Ms. Madden, actually it wasn't. It increased taxes across the board on all income levels. So it was regressive. Just curious, Mr. Smith, do you support increasing taxes, regressive taxes, that is, on tobacco, sales, corporate, alcohol? Is this something that your organization supports? Do you support the gas tax that Governor Dayton is proposing right now?
Yes, Representative Anderson, we support taxes. We think taxes are important and valuable. We think that taxes are the price we pay for civilization. We like progressive taxation overall. We favor the income tax, but we understand that there are features in the sales and the property tax that are also valuable, such as there being more stability in those forms of taxes. And most of the things our governments do actually have a progressive impact. They provide for public investment that levels opportunity. And so on the spending side, you have to realize that transportation is good for business and for ordinary citizens, too.
Chair Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So basically what you're saying is there's not a tax you don't like, but that's good. Good to have that feedback and information. Thank you, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I'm sure we could find a tax we don't like. I would like to address, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, the question of donors. We actually have a lot of donors who...
Mr. Smith, I really don't care who you
are. Oh, darn.
I was just teasing.
We divulge them all.
We are past time, and if members are concerned about the donors of these two groups, please talk to Mr. Smith.
And many of them are happy to pay their estate taxes.
And they're happy to pay them. Okay. With that, Representative McDonald renews his motion House File 493 be laid over for possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. Members, thank you for your work today.
Thank you, Chairman.
All the time.
Committee members.